Hello, fabulous humans. Today, I'm delighted to introduce to you Julie Nyes, who's a medical scientist at Biteflies. Biteflies are producing a personalized wearable seizure monitoring device, bit of a mouthful, which is like a mini EEG, which you place behind your ear, and it's much more subtle than a regular EEG. This is generally for people with refractory epilepsy, so uncontrolled seizures, and to effectively, fingers crossed, improve their quality of life, and so that they can have their seizures, fingers crossed, more effectively treated. Provide you really useful information, basically, for the clinician. Julie is somebody who's just a lovely person and has become much more interested in actually how epilepsy affects people as a whole, their quality of life, how it affects people psychologically, in addition to, neurologically. So if you're interested in learning more about her work, please continue to listen and to watch, or make sure you subscribe to the channel. And let's get ready to hear more from Julie. Thank you so much for being with me and everybody watching, listening. Can you tell everybody a bit about yourself, please?
Thank you, first and all, for inviting me. If I see the past speakers or the people you interviewed, it's really an honor to be here. And also, I like that you introduce people from different backgrounds in epilepsy community and field. So I'm a medical scientist ambassador at Biteflies. So I had a background. I studied biochemistry, so I'm trained as a scientist. But my parents are in social care, etc. So I always, wanted to make a difference. It sounds cheesy, but it's true. So after 10 years, I think, in academia, I was approached by Biteflies, which is a med tech company here in Belgium, who really have the mission of bringing wearable technology to outside the hospital to people who need it to follow up their health and help professionals take better care of them. So I'm in the group working on epilepsy. That's why I'm here, evidently, and how I met you, I think, 2 years ago in
I think
Brussels.
it's three now because before lockdown and a good, and I think about a year before that.
Time flies. So where we have been active in, with a lot of amazing neurologists, researchers, private companies, other startups, to work together to develop kind of a wearable seizure detection device. But in the end, much more than that. Really, also, okay, how do we bring it to market? How do we get it into the hands of neurologists? What does it need to get in clinical practice? Instead of just making a device, it's more about, okay, what tool is really needed to track people at home that are diagnosed with epilepsy, and what can help not only the neurologist, but how can we also empower, the people affected, the families, the caregivers, but also governments, regulations. How can everybody better understand what is missing in the field,
Yeah,
eh?
yeah, yeah.
When are seizures happening, how many are happening, how can we, push that boundary forward? That's a bit what we do. So our team is working on Epic Care at Home, it's called, which is, basically a tool, which is hardware, software, patient guidance, education, etc., to people that have a known diagnosis. So it's not a diagnostic tool, but really ones where you already have a background into the etiology of the person, how follow them up in their daily life, in the comfort of their living room, when they're going to school, having a party, or coming together with family, but also in stressed situations, maybe as a kid, the day before Santa Claus comes, or the day before you have a big test at school. These are often, the periods where seizures might be
Yeah,
triggered.
stress or excitement even. A load of kids have them around Christmas and New Year because all these exciting presents. It's too much, man. You can't be too happy. You're gonna have a seizure.
Exactly. But there's nobody there, or there's no, how you say, a medical device hooked up to you to measure it. So we want to do that in a discreet way, because I understand it should be not too obtrusive, in a comfortable way. So that's where wearable technology, and I think other technologies in the field from other companies as well, digital tools, better education, better care can help to capture what's really happening in life, when you're doing the things you do on a daily basis.
So that people can picture this, so the device. So, guys, I've worn this and I, yes, totally look hot with it on, of course. But so, this is for temporal lobe, correct?
For now, yes, and for absence seizures, as well.
Yeah. So, yeah, like I've worn it behind, I've like applied it myself, put it on behind my ears, as I said, looking hot as. And With a few wires and stuff, and it's like something on your phone that links up to there. And but since I gave it a shot, things have come on further. I think like really sort of advanced, you've advanced the development of the product and the service, right?
Exactly, because I think when you were running, it was still with cup electrodes, and then we went away for that. So I think the biggest change is, yeah, maybe I show it like...
Oh, you got it there, cool.
For, yeah, to measure brain activity, you need electrodes, and you need something close to your right. head, right? You have the headbands, which of course can be useful for during the night or when you're in your home, but a lot of people are also not really comfortable with wearing it all the time. So we are also, together with some private partners and researchers in Belgium, developing these patches. So they go behind your ear, so you almost don't see them. I should have put them on. So they go like this, right? So you don't have to put them in the hair, or it takes like 5 minutes to put them on yourself. And they actually stick quite well. And the goal is to measure indeed brain activity from behind the ear. So a bit like hearing devices. We tested this of course also with the input from people with epilepsy and how they feel comfortable about it. And we're still improving it to make you be able to sleep with it, wear glasses with it, you're wearing the headphones, all of these things that actually happen in daily life. We want to make it as the best compatible fit, but still making sure that the data that's collected is really clinically accurate, because yeah, our value is also towards the neurologist to have better insights, but that means better insights means good data, which they can make, that they can understand and that they can make better clinical decisions on. So,
which is, can be good because you don't have to faff about like going to the hospital, because I think sometimes that's a real pain, like can really stress people out, can make you tired, especially if you've got a long distance, you've got to travel and it's like, oh my God, this person's going to like faff about with my scalp, and like lots of people aren't comfortable with that. And then there's the scratchiness as well. Sometimes, I mean, I don't really care. It's just a bit of a scratch, but some people are quite sensitive to that. So
yeah, indeed. And especially also with children or people live far away from the hospital. I live in Belgium and Europe, which is still quite okay. Everything is quite close by, but I can imagine in the US or in other countries where the next epilepsy center might be 5 hours exactly. away. And as a parent, you need to take a day off from work. You need to try. And as a kid, it's also, yes, a scary environment. So being at home is always better, I think. But we do want to make sure we don't give the hopes of like, okay, we're going to replace the hospital. We still think video EEG has its tremendous advantage for diagnostic purposes and to really, yeah, or pre-surgical evaluation, right? All these type of things stay important. We want to be an additional tool, you know, a bit of a building the bridge between what they do in a hospital, but giving it an extension and building the bridge towards, yeah, what you report yourself or what you observe, your diary, if you even have one, because it's also a huge burden, I think, but kind of, yeah, backing you up, giving you a backpack with real world data and like what's happening with your physiology, your sleep, your heart rhythm.
Yeah, because people just think about the brain, but they often, I think, and by people, I mean often those of us who are not clinicians or scientists think, oh, it's just about the brain. And then if you put electrodes on your head, any abnormal or OTT brain activity will be identified. And it's not that simple, right? And I know lots of people that have, myself included actually, who've been in for video telemetry, so in EEG whilst you're being videoed, and nothing abnormal or extracurricular activity was identified. I was chilling out, man. And this is really common. And so that's why I think ambulatory EEG, so ones you can have at home, can be really useful because you're in your regular environment, but you know, it's still something that takes up a lot of time to apply these EEGs. I mean, neurophysiologists that do it are amazing. It takes a lot of, you know, incredible, immeasurable skill, you know, and then you've got your like lovely little pack that you have on the side called like a handbag or...
Like a purse.
Yeah, with all your lovely wires and stuff. And so your product doesn't in any way replace that, but it's kind of more chilled out than that.
Yeah. I think, and also it's really more to, of course, you need all these, yeah, these many electrodes and the video are of course to help the neurologist really make, yeah, differential diagnosis. Is this really epilepsy or not? Where is it localized? But then indeed, like you say, it's really a spot check. It's a snapshot. And if nothing happens, it's very expensive, expensive as well. Sometimes you have to stay 5 days in the hospital, also due to privacy reasons, being watched all the time. There are more pleasant things, I think, to do. So we want to, help. It's really a tool to count seizures that were already characterized before. So a neurologist already has kind of your fingerprint in a way, your unique pattern, because it's very different from person to person, we notice. But if you have that, you can look at and look for these patterns in the home environment and now better have an idea of how many are happening, right? And when are they happening?
How long they last?
How long do they last? Is the medication that the person is on working or not? Or are the side, maybe the medication is working and they are seizure free or almost seizure free, but maybe the side effects are affecting sleep. Like, it's really a tool to, instead of doing guesswork and empirically trying to go, try this, really speed that up and get the right person on the right treatment or the right care pathway as soon as possible. Because I've heard that from your personal story as well, this can take 10, 15, 20 years, which really blows my mind of there is technology, we can get more data, we can back up the neurologist and the persons affected. Like, we could speed this up so much more, also to a certain extent.
Yeah.
I think other technologies will be needed and new drug development, new other devices, gene therapy, which is
exciting,
really cool.
Exciting stuff.
So I think that all together will help speed that up in a way and also reduce the costs to not only the families, but society, to hospitals, and really make it more tailored and targeted, specific. Those are the typical things I think we are striving for.
Yeah, because if you, the longer it takes to get controlled seizures, if you're lucky enough to, of course, receive that, there'll be a reduction in expense to the hospitals, fewer ambulance rides. This is generalizing, of course, but, in treatments and potential surgeries, as you know, like fractured clavicle because of bad seizure and stuff, and then also, if you can get more effective treatment earlier as a result of things like this, then you can hopefully reduce the, or at least the period of time that you have to wait to, or to experience very common psychiatric comorbidities, just address things earlier, more effectively. And also, it's just like really quite fun to do at home, I think. Like, I understand that some people get stressed out about it and stuff, but I think it's really cool to have some personal involvement in your actual monitoring of your brain activity, and there's like people, your colleague that helps people, put this on, she's amazing.
Yeah, we think that the human factor is, you can bring a device to the neurologist and you can build an app and a dashboard like software to help visualize the data to the neurologist. But then you mentioned, I think one of the also important factors is the human touch, and the feel of, we will help you get this straight, because we see that with a lot of people we are measuring that they're super engaged, super interested. They want also feedback, like, how am I doing? Did I do it right? What is my brain telling? How is this gonna help my neurologist? And there you see so much interest and they want to do well and they're really looking for, okay, what's gonna have the impact now next on my track record? Because We do get a lot of the question, is it also giving an alarm, etc.? That's not the case yet. We're really focusing on just extending that monitoring period outside the hospital. That's like our first, let's say, goal and helping getting that on that faster treatment. But that doesn't mean in the future, indeed, when algorithms and software, the buzzword AI gets better, then we can take that step. But you have to be very careful before going there to make sure you're, what you alarm is really something real, right? So I think there's already a lot of value in just monitoring and having insights in your disease progression or the how the epilepsy evolves over time and how you should match that to the right treatment options. That's already a huge value on its own, I think.
I completely agree. I see, understandably, like lots of people with epilepsy and other diseases, they'll say, well, I want this device or this app to do this. Well, sometimes it's better to have a device that does something brilliantly. It's of high quality, the data is reliable, rather than having your finger in so many little pies and it's all a bit pants, we'd much rather have quality over quantity of functions. And I think that's what you guys are doing right now, isn't it? Like focusing on quality readings, as you say, to provide information, data to your clinicians, but at the same time, making it really cool for the people using it.
Yeah. And you are the one, yeah, always pushing for that, the coolness factor and making it, especially when you go, because this product is also for children, so for pediatric purposes. And yeah, there you also have to be very careful that they want to wear it and that it also feels them empowered instead of, I don't know, making them feel more stigmatized and that the parents feel supported, etc. So it's very interesting to work with these different types of families and neurologists and also actually to look at the competitive space. I don't like the word competitive because I feel we're actually more synergistic than competition at this point, because there's of course many other device companies or digital therapeutics or more software platforms that try to integrate many epilepsy care centers more together. Like, you know, we're all pulling on the same cord and I don't feel it's direct competition, because as you know, epilepsy is super complex and everybody has kind of their unique profile and needs. And I think you can also not expect from one company or one software or one device to help all of them, right? We need to be kind of a portfolio, and then the neurologist or someone and the families themselves, depending on their context, depending on their needs, can then decide which one fits the best, or a combination of them. Like, you can wear a watch and you can wear our system, or maybe you have it's better to have a subscalp EEG as well. I mean, there are many options, a lot of cool technologies getting there. I think the biggest hurdle for most of them, or at least the ones that are not consumer focused but focusing on being a medical device and being in the hands of hospitals and then prescribed by neurologists towards people affected, we have to go through a lot of certification, medical regulation, right, to prove safety and efficacy, which I think is really good. But then that part is manageable. But then you also have to show to governments and payers, hey, this needs to be reimbursed both for the patient and the neurologist. Because this, you can imagine already, if you start measuring at home a few days, a few weeks, all this data, big data, also needs to be processed, needs to be looked at. And we are doing our best to build analytics or like software to help find regions that could potentially be relevant for clinical decisions. But still, it will take some time of neurologists to review, and they also need to learn to deal with this new type of data. And there, showing the economical value as well towards society and of course towards the personal lives of those affected, that's going to be very important to get reimbursement and get epilepsy really on the high priority list, not only of research but also of how to change care pathways, because it didn't change for the last 20-25 years. There's billing codes for neurologists or hospitals for a classical video EEG visit, but then it's and maybe 1 or 2 days ambulatory EEG, but that's it.
Exactly. It's like, and often that isn't enough. And we were talking about some papers that we've read in different countries of the financial expense to countries and economies of refractory epilepsy. And it is absolutely huge. Like, we're talking billions per year. And some of the, numbers that we were talking about, we think are underestimated anyway, right? And so for every single person in the world investing in this type of technology, to benefit people with epilepsy and their families, there is this ripple effect to the rest of society, and it will actually reduce the amount of money that is spent on caring for or treating people with epilepsy, as well as kind of like bettering their lives and making their lives worth living, you know?
We have to prove this, and that will be, there's a huge willingness of neurologists and also organizations. So a lot of people are talking about it. A lot of people say it will be a big blocker. But that's what I love about Biflies, for instance, is we don't step away from that challenge. You know, it's like, maybe we're still a company that's growing, we're a small team, but we're confident with the right partners, with the right connections. And there's a lot of super willing neurologists that see the value, pharma industry, other tech companies. It's amazing what we can do together. And I think that realization is coming, and we shouldn't be afraid for something that's not there. Somebody has to pioneer it, right? And we're not going to step back because we see how much it's needed, and it's been a long time enough that nothing has changed. So somebody has to do it. Of course, we need to find the financial means and build the network to do that. But I think the future looks bright to believe in that. And I'm happy I'm in a company that says, yeah, we don't step back. We go for this. It's needed. We put ourselves behind it. We'll see what comes on the way and try to be agile and yeah, take as much knowledge from other people into account and collaborate with the right people to convince people.
It's
right?
not about ego and making money. I mean, obviously that kind of comes in handy sometimes, motivation, but that's not what this is about. It's about improving. And just to a really cool thing I think to end on is you were going to tell us about a lovely story of somebody, of course, whose ID you won't disclose, but who was pregnant and you helped her with her epilepsy. Just tell us about that.
We were talking before about the shift from being in clinical research to clinical practice. And the most, yeah, for me, motivating, and I think for the whole company working on this, is when you close that loop and you see the clinical value. So indeed, there was a story where we were working with a hospital here in Belgium with a lovely epileptologist. And she we just did a small demo or introduced what EpiCare at Home was, what for which patients is valuable. And she said, oh, actually, I saw one of my patients was actually, I saw her last week, she's pregnant. So she had to switch medication to safeguard safety
some drugs aren't best when you're pregnant.
Exactly. So she had to switch, and she started to feel she was diagnosed with she had a juvenile absence epilepsy before, but she was actually seizure free, and now she started to feel absences again, or she felt she was absent, and she was getting really stressed about it. Of course, with the pregnancy as well, there's of course a time issue. So the neurologist called us and said, okay, I want to try this, and also the person affected said, I see a lot of value in this. So we teamed up. Time was crucial. We measured, I think, for 1 week. So we measured her brain activity with these behind the ear adhesives and the wearable technology. And we looked at her brain activity, and she herself also reported how many seizures she thought she had.
And I bet it was way more, was it? Did she have way more than she thought?
Yeah, I think we got 5 times more. So on average, she had like 30 a day. And she only reported, 5 times less. But based on that combined information, still valuable information from herself, and I think her partner, her husband, together with the data we could, objective data we could collect, and we were sitting at the desk with the neurologist, and she was calling her assistant, like, come and watch, look how well the seizures are represented. You can really see the absences in the raw EEG traces. And she's like, yeah, okay, this is way too much for 1 day. Indeed, we need to switch, we need to increase the medication. She was also happy, like she only had to look at the data, but all the support during the week we did with our patient care experts. So she called with the patient to make sure the adhesives were good. We had a team in the background checking the quality of the data, right? To make sure, because the time was also very sensitive to measure it. And then seeing that immediately value and making it more predictable. Okay, she has so many seizures, probably average a day. The neurologist felt much more informed. And then she made a certain decision to I think, increase the dosage of the new drug and then follow her up again. But closing that loop felt so good. I came out of that meeting and I was like, this is why we do it. And this is just one story, right? I hope and we're building much more. But if you tell this also to, like, imagine she didn't have that and she was just relying on the diary and they didn't get to that right medication. She was, I don't know what the risk factor is of then having stress and all these other types of having or more severe
seizures. Hormonal differences
as well.
And being tired because she's pregnant and so many different things. But it's interesting though, obviously this is just a one-off and we don't want listeners to think, oh, this is the same for everybody. It's not the case. It's just
one
example of a great thing that can happen. But I know of one person. She ended up in hospital, unfortunately, status epilepticus, and for quite a long time, it was awful. And anyway, and then she said to me, we were texting, oh, I've had one seizure today. Anyway, it was something like 5-6 times as many seizures, and she had no idea. And they were tonic-clonic seizures because her memory was just busted by the seizures themselves and the drugs and everything, and it was just really interesting for her. And so that's why I kind of put these two things together. And like when I spoke to one other person, another one of our podcasts, Rohit Shankar, and he was talking about how there was, because one of his patients was nonverbal, they were not an of intellectual disability, they could not communicate to him directly what was going on, but his mum and dad thought that he was having a certain type of seizure and was telling Rohit this, but it was not the case. He wasn't, the person was not having these types of seizures and stuff. So Rohit eventually found this out after quite some time, because obviously there's communication issues, and then changed this person's drugs, which was amazing for improving his life. You know, but this could happen sooner if you have a good sort of system, assuming you have temporal lobe epilepsy, you know, to find information like this out about people. And like you say, we've got a while to go, but this is like realistic hope for people. And I think that's amazing.
We're not in the alarming and the prediction. And of course, the field is working towards there. It's a long term vision, but the value you can already reach with just, yeah, characterizing seizures, but also basic physiology that is happening, can already tell you so much more than what we were doing right now with the guesswork and the burden. Because I can imagine, I mean, you can better testimony to this, but every time you have an appointment with your neurologist every so many months, oh, I have to what happened, and I need to make sure and remember everything. And like you say, yeah, what if you're nonverbal? What if you lost your mind? What if you live alone? What if they happen during the night? There's so many unknowns which we push on the shoulders of the families. And also for neurologists must be very frustrating compared to their colleagues, for instance, who work, I don't know, in other disease fields where you do a test or you do a screening, there's a value. Okay, bomb. This is this or that. And now I adjust. For them, it's, I mean, I really have a lot of respect for neurologists and epileptologists, for, yeah, dealing with the soul of people, dealing with their life track based on so little data. So, I mean, it's hard, of course, on the families, but I wouldn't disregard the powerless they also feel. And I noticed that in the collaborations we have, that a lot of them are willing, especially also the young generation, are willing to take these new tools on and explore, give it a shot. Maybe it doesn't fit for certain amount of people, but it does fit for others. And some of them even say after a first meeting, oh yeah, I will help you with the documentation towards the government, right, to get reimbursement. I really want to push this forward. And I'm like, wow, like to feel that motivation and eagerness, I was really surprised by that.
In a positive way, surprised, because yeah, that's, and there are heaps of us out there, heaps of people with epilepsy and mums and dads carers who are up for this. We just, and for helping out, it's just a case of, well, hopefully this helps, but making people more aware of what you do and that you're there and that you're open to this. And just another example, and we'll let you go in a sec, but everybody, I had Bikeflies invited me to do a talk at their company recently because they wanted to understand what it's like just for, yeah, I'm just one person, but from the perspective of somebody with epilepsy, especially refractory epilepsy and comorbidities, and then of course mentioning other people that I know who are amazing and what it's like for them. And so that's what is a really positive thing that we have today, is companies like yours actually caring about the individuals that you're hoping to help long term and taking into account our perspectives, because it's pretty important if we're the ones that are going to be using the tool or the product, whatever. It's got to be cool, darling, you know.
Yeah, exactly. And it's not just about the thing. That's why I think our leadership decided also to invite you, because they poke on this every day. It's the impact. It's not the technology, the cool, you can make the best product, the coolest technology, the coolest algorithm, whatever. Always keep that impact in mind, you know. We call this our Bikeflies coefficient. It's a mathematical way, but it's, instead of other companies have often these KPIs, and you were in finances and objectives, etc. For us, that's all centered to what is the impact. And with that, the story of the pregnant lady, that's one that it's difficult to put a number on it, but that's what you should strive for. And then that spirit, or you could call it even a bite flies religion, I really vote for. I'm an atheist, but for that part, I'm part of the gang fully.
I'll be with you. I'll join.
Check.
Okay, Brill, thanks so much for joining us today, Julie. I've been waiting months to interview you because you and your company are amazing. So thank you.
Thank you for the opportunity, and keep raising awareness. I think it's as equally as important.